USA to welcome today's speaker and my beloved principal, sir, Dr. S.S. Engineering. Sir, please.
Thank you, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
It's my proud privilege to introduce the resource person of the session, who happens to be the principal of the college. Dr. S.S. Engineering is a proud alumni of the Basaveswara Engineering College, completing his BE during 1981 to 85. He completed his M.Tech from IIT Madras during 1991 to 1993. He secured his PhD degree from IIT Madras in the year 2007. During his BE degree, he secured second rank to the university in the year 1985. During his long career of 35 years of service, he has worked in various capacities like Dean Academic Planning and Development, President of MHRD's IIC, Member of College Level Monitoring Committee, KITS, Government of Karnataka, and Coordinator of Phase TechEP 2 and TechEP 3, Director BVS IIPS EdExcel UK, and Coordinator BVVS IIPS EdExcel UK. He has published more than 15 papers in international journals and conferences, and he has got the appreciation letter from NPI New Delhi in 2018 for effective implementation of TechEP 3 activities at BEC. He has also secured an appreciation letter from Lions and Lioness Club, Bagalkot, for human service rendered in the field of education. And sir is the president of IIC. Under his presidency, BEC IIC was shortlisted as one of the top 25 IICs at All India level. And sir was awarded for this feat by Minister of MHRD, Sri Pokhriyal, during 2019. During 2018 and 19, BEC IIC was awarded with 4 stars, and during 1920, BEC IIC has secured 4.5 stars. So with this brief introduction, I present you Dr. S.S. Engineering, sir, to the August gathering. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Now it's my pleasure, and I'm very happy and glad to invite and request our principal, sir, to start over the session. Sir, please.
Thank you, sir, and thanks to Professor Anil. I think my screen is visible now.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Today, it gives me immense pleasure to talk a little about the National Education Policy 2020, which is most talked about. Disturbance, Professor. Anil.
Sir, why is it called, sir?
Why is it called, sir? Thank you, look at. In North Martin, just 1 minute. I'll just check my settings. Is this okay?
Now it's okay, sir.
Okay. Yeah, I just outlined my...
Still, there is an echo, sir.
Hello. How to reduce this echo? Just trying to look at. Now is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay. So just a little broad way of presenting things in a very nutshell within the timeline that is being given. First, let me talk a little about the background and the introduction of this National Education Policy. Then in brief for a little about the education in India, and next is about our focus should be on technical education, emphasis on innovation and entrepreneurship, then making it happen, and the conclusions. Just to give you a little background, in September 2015, the General Assembly of United Nations, it adopted the 2030 agenda. We need to appreciate that is in 15 years ahead of time, the things are being set and for the development of the mankind. So this was for basically the sustainable development, and it was broadly covered into 17 goals, and they have been called as sustainable development goals. So in that, the emphasis for education is of importance. Why I am trying to talk about this is there are other areas in which the United Nations always focuses, but today's current scenario or the topic is about the education. Then building on the principle of leaving no one behind, the fundamental principle here with regards to the UN is that taking all the countries into consideration, leaving no one behind, the new agenda emphasizes a holistic approach for achieving the sustainable development. So if you look at the goal number 4, it talks about the quality education, that is to ensure inclusive and equitable quality education. The 17 sustainable development goals, the 4th one is on the quality of education. Rest all are there: zero hunger, no poverty, then gender equality, then clean water, sanitation. So it focuses on many areas. So now for the today, we'll be only talking about with respect to the quality education, the national education policy implemented in India to, in order to see that the quality of education is enhanced. So these are the other 17 or the goals which have been set by the UN. Then targets and objectives of these sustainable development goals in education, if you look at it, one of the things, targets, is that early childhood development and universal pre-primary education. So in this, to ensure that by 2030, all girls and boys of every country have access to quality-based early childhood development, suitable pre-primary education and primary education. That's one of the fundamental things. Then equal access to technical work, an emphasis is also being made. So all these targets are for 2030. By 2030, increase substantially the number of youths and adults having employability skills, including technical skills, vocational skills for available jobs and entrepreneurship. Now here, in the present context, we all are now seeing the statistics with regards to the technical education. Out of the total number of graduates who pass out of the technical institutions, a mockery is being made about the quality of the graduates coming out of these educational institutions. So one of the surveys mentions that 80% of the graduates who come out of the technical institutions are not employable. So taking that into consideration, now the onus lies on the teachers and the administrators and the educational institutions to provide quality education to our students. So the more emphasis should be given to that. Now coming to the Indian scenario of higher education, India has over 890 universities and approximately 40,000 colleges, reflecting the overall severe fragmentation and small size higher education institutions currently in the country. So they are all in a different modalities, like there is no uniformity among these institutions. So you have quantitatively grown up tremendously, but in my opinion, we are qualitatively lagging behind. So remarkably, over 40% of all colleges in the country run only a single program, far from the multidisciplinary style of higher education that will be required in the 21st century. So the more emphasis is now in the coming days that the national education policy emphasizes is that it should become multidisciplinary. So majority of the now colleges in the country, they are all having single programs. So we don't have interdisciplinary or the multidisciplinary programs. And in fact, over 20% of the colleges have enrollment below 100. See, this is a very saddening thing. while only 4% of the colleges have enrollment over 3000. So it speaks the wide disparity that exists between the institutions across the country. And some of the reasons for fragmentation of higher education system in India, which have been identified: early streaming of students into different disciplines, then lack of access, especially socioeconomic disadvantaged areas. Present gross enrollment ratio is approximated to only 25%. Then what I would rather rate is the lack of teacher and institutional autonomy. Though Basaveshwar Engineering College, Bagalkot, we are considered to be autonomous, affiliated to Vishveshwara Technological University, Belagavi. But in a true sense, what the autonomy is being experienced by higher learning institutions like IITs of national importance, that is NITs, the colleges which have been granted autonomy since 2007 under the World Bank scheme truly are not autonomous. They are all functioning like a miniature universities in their subdomains. So this is very much important in terms of either learning flexibility for the students or in terms of the teaching for the teaching fraternity. And inadequate mechanisms for career management and progression of faculty and institutional leaders. So we do not have sufficient mechanisms for the growth of the people who are in administrations, nor the management people have been trained for this. The lack of research at most of the universities and colleges. So rather I'll be blamed if I make this sarcastic statement. In India and by and large in majority of the engineering colleges, research is at a very nascent stage. We cannot be now called as the research institutions. We are basically an undergraduate teaching learning institutions. That we must remember, and our main focus should be on teaching learning. It is not that we should not promote research, but to the extent that is desired, and that is the core research which needs to be emphasized. Then suboptimal governance and leadership of higher educational institutions. That's why now people are also attending so many management training programs at various institutions. Then a poor regulatory system allowing fake colleges to thrive while constraining excellent innovative institutions. So the one of the major problems is the regulatory systems. And apart from that, there are too many regulatory bodies. See, for example, an engineering college like ours is being bound and governed by so many authorities, you will be astonished to hear the list or the names. So we are bound by VTU, we are bound by Director of Technical Education, Government of Karnataka, then Principal Secretary, Higher Education, then MHRD, UGC, AICT, and many more bodies like this. So it becomes highly difficult for institutions like ours to have a real autonomy. By 2030-32, India is expected to be the third largest economy at over 10 trillion. This is what is being anticipated. And our 10 trillion economy will not be driven by natural resources, but by knowledge resources. This is a very meaningful statement, rather I would say. We are rich basically in our natural resources, as well as we are knowledge powerhouses. But the thing is that the in-house, that is the Indian government, doesn't capitalize or make use of this particular knowledge resources. So there's all a big brain drain where the students or the students with good brains fly off from the country. So in this context, the Prime Minister's recent call on leveraging the fourth industrial revolution to take India to new heights was the main call. So in that particular context, we should appreciate. Are you able to hear me? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. So the vision of the national education policy, rather I would say, an education system rooted in Indian ethos that contributes directly to transforming India, that is Mera Bharat Mahan, sustainably into an equitable and vibrant knowledge society by providing high quality education to all, thus making India a global knowledge superpower. Many a times I tell in the class to the students that if our students are little more focused and if our teachers lay a little more emphasis than what we are doing today, in days to come, I would rather assure that India will be definitely the global knowledge power or the superpower. That's also being envisaged in the national education policy. Now, the various stages with regards to the life cycle for the education system, they have been classified into different types: pre-primary school level, primary school level, high school level, pre-university level, college level, university level, doctoral level, postdoctoral level, and the last one is the lifelong learning. So each one of us definitely agree that learning is a lifelong process. It does not just end with the graduation or attaining a degree or acquiring a degree. The evolution of the education policy, if you look at the previous one being in 1986, the National Education Policy, which was modified in 1992, and in 2019, it was being presented by Dr. K. Kasturirangan, the committee report, and 2020, our beloved Prime Minister, Sri Narendra Modi ji, has laid emphasis for this National Education Policy. If you look at this, it is a big leap, I would rather say, in the field of education. Almost 14 plus 20, that is 34 years have passed where there has not been much of change in the educational system. So we must know that with the technological changes, how fast is the world galloping, and in every walk and in every field of our life, day-to-day life, we basically as a human being require a change, and every policy requires a change. We cannot be lingering around the old policies for a very long duration. The one of the important aspects as a constitutional provision is the Right to Education Act 2009, which aims to provide primary education to all children aged 6 to 14 years and enforces education as a fundamental right. So we must be aware and we must discourage the child labor, and every human being who is born is entitled to have the basic education, and which government aims at it. Just as an introductory part, the National Education Policy 2020 is the first new education policy in the 21st century. The last one I taught 34 years back in 1986. This National Education Policy replaces the National Policy of Education in 1986, which was modified in 1992. Then in June 2017, the Committee for the Draft NEP was constituted under the chairmanship of Dr. K. Kasturirangan, former chief of ISRO, which submitted a report on 31st of May 2019. Then NEP 2020 has been formulated after having considered nearly 2 lakh suggestions from 2.5 lakh gram panchayats, 6,600 blocks, and 6,000 urban local bodies, and 676 districts. That means there has been a huge exercise that is being done in order to bring out this particular policy. It is not that it has been floated in a minute or all of a sudden. So the effort that is being made by the government should be well appreciated. And as a citizen of India, it's our responsibility to take it forward and support the government. NEP aims at producing engaged, productive, and contributing citizens for building an equitable, inclusive, and plural society. NEP also 2020 suggests a slew of reforms to school education with a focus on flexibility of subjects and eliminating silos between streams of learning. So we are just like a frog in the well with only confined curriculum, where students are not having enough scope to learn the subjects of their choice or their interest. The another goal of NEP is to achieve 100% gross enrollment ratio in a preschool to secondary level by 2030. NEP changes the existing 10 plus 2 structure of school education to a different model known as 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4, covering children between the ages of 3 to 18. So what this 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4 can be well understood through this. So on the left side, what you see is the existing academic structure, which is 10 plus 2, first to 10th standard, then pre-university college or PUC, that is 2 years. This is 16 to 18 age, and this is 6 to 16. Now the present format is 5U, that is 3 years, up to 3 years it is Anganwadi. Then next 2 years is class 1 and 2. So up to the second standard, it is called as the foundational. Then next 3 years, from class 3 to 5, it is preparatory. Then from class 6 to 8, it is the middle schooling. Then from 9 to 12, it is the secondary schooling. So this format of 10 plus 2 now has been changed to 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4, basically into foundational up to second standard, then up to 3rd to 5th preparatory, then middle 6 to 8, then secondary, that is age group of 14 to 18 from the class 9 to 12. So this is same thing being represented. The one more important or few more important things are, NEP also aims to promote multilingualism and a learning of native languages. So more of emphasis is also being given to the local languages. Then board exams will be made easier relatively, testing primarily the core competencies on the capacities rather than rote learning. Instead of by-hearting and reproducing the things and earning the grades, so the board exams will now emphasize and focus on the primary core competencies of an individual that are going to be tested. Now some of the highlights that are being broadcast by the newspapers or the medias, this is what you will see in your newspapers, which are being highlighted, the learning plan, then the emphasis for the digital drive and things like that. So in this particular case, there has been more emphasis for the digital drive, because the recent pandemic has thrown open many challenges to shift from offline mode to online mode. So in that particular context also, the digital drive plays a very dominant role in national education policy. Then with regards to the reforms, one of the important and the key factors is the training of teachers. The policy not only aims to transform education, but also to improve the skills of those facilitating the education, that is basically the teachers or the faculty members. Policy seeks to institute a large number of merit-based scholarships across the country for studying quality 4-year integrated B.Ed. program. Then teachers' eligibility tests, this is going to be made mandatory. Strengthened to inculcate better test material and the scores of the same taken into account for recruitment purposes. So everybody has to pass before taking up the job of teaching. And teachers will also be offered at least 50 hours of per year continuous professional development workshops, because enhancement of skill and knowledge is of utmost importance, as it is being emphasized that lifelong learning. Minimum a faculty or a teacher has to undergo at least 50 hours of the workshops, professional development workshops every year. By 2030, teacher education will be moved into multidisciplinary universities, and the minimum degree qualification for teaching will be a 4-year integrated B.Ed. Now currently it is only 9 months, or subsequently only 2 years, but now it's going to be 4 years. Then additionally, teachers will not participate in activities such as electioneering, so that they are able to better devote their time to teaching. Many times the primary school teachers and the high school teachers are being entrusted the work of electioneering and the surveys of the government, what it takes up. So these all are going to be now set apart for the teaching fraternity, which is a relief rather, I would say. So these are some of the aspects of education, NEP in general. Now our focus will be on the technical education, that is, National Education Policy has renamed the Ministry of Human Resources and Development, MHRD, as the Ministry of Education. So this is a very good sign, rather I would say, a sign of country's changing focus on education. The fundamentally, it also emphasizes that it is not just what it is traditionally, and it emphasizes more on the education part. The little introductory part about the technical education. Technical education includes, all of us know, degree and diploma programs in engineering, technology management, then architecture, town planning, Form C, hotel management, and catering and technology. There is a great need for closer collaboration between industry and institution to drive innovation and research. So one of the emphasis for the technical education or in the field of technical education is integration between the academic institution and the industries, wherein the students must have the hands-on experience, and before they pass out of the institution, they should be employable. Then technical education requires individual creativity. Hello. Hello. Hello.
Shweta.
Can you just mute the person who is having some kind of a disturbance there? Can you mute his microphone?
Yes, I muted it.
Yeah. Thank you very much. So technical education requires individual creativity and application of both knowledge and skill on the part of the teacher as well as the students. It's not just enough for a teacher to transform the material from the books to in the classroom to the students. So the more onus now lies also on the teaching fraternity, where now they have to be more creative than the students themselves. So it's the need of the hour. With regards to the curriculum to strengthen the undergraduate degrees, curricula must be renewed with a focus on opportunities rather than just transforming the things. Engineering and technology programs have to be revised to prepare professionals who are well prepared for both current as well as the future practices. It is not just enough that if we prepare our graduates for the present needs, we should also be in a position to forecast the needs and the demands or the challenges that we are going to encounter in the days to come. And we should have a curricula such that we are able to prepare the graduates who will also be able to face the challenges of the next generation. Then the technical programs should exploit emerging science and technology and should be responsive to changing socio-economical and environmental contexts. So our living conditions and living standards are changing. The environmental conditions are also changing very drastically. So we should also lay emphasis on these particular aspects. As a human being, we basically need all these things to be met with. Curricula will be frequently renewed, infused with a set of carefully selected material from other disciplines. So it's going to be interdisciplinary. Curriculum delivery will focus on giving students the ability to apply their knowledge and skills in different unknown settings and inculcating professional dispositions and ethics. The gap between the education and practice will be removed through a focus on preparing professionals capable of analyzing society's problems. So the most important thing now is to understand the problems faced by the common man in society and to address those and to make our students ready for that. Holistic undergraduate education with a flexible curriculum can be of 3 to 4 years with multiple exit options and appropriate certification within this period. This in a way is a boon to the student fraternity, but rather I do not know in the days to come what I foresee will definitely have a hit on the educational institutions, because the present format of a fixed input till they pass out is a guarantee or assurance for the learning institutions or the educational institutions to have a fixed income. But in the present context, if the students after the end of 1 year of study is going to have a certificate gained and leave that particular program, then it is going to be a little difficult for the educational institutions to sustain. I do not know what are the modalities that will be incorporated for the sustainability of the institution, but in my opinion, if the government does not take care of this, then it is the self-sustenance of the institution where they need to gear up and be prepared for this. So it's going to be a major challenge for the educational institutions, because most of the educational institutions are being run by private bodies. Then multidisciplinary education and research universities on par with IITs and IIMs to be set up as models of best multidisciplinary education on global standards in the country. So apart from enhancing the quality, it also looks at the standards across the globe, and it wants the education system in India and the educational institution to have the education system on par with other institutions across the globe. And there is also going to be the focus on some of the upcoming areas like artificial intelligence, 3D machining, big data analysis, and machine learning, and among others in technical education, that is genomic studies, biotechnology, nanotechnology, neuroscience, and etc. All these are going to be done with a curriculum framework to be monitored and set up by the agencies like National Academies of Sciences and the Indian National Academy of Engineering, what we call it as INAE. They are going to be entrusted the responsibility of looking into the development of the curriculum. So one of the focuses of NEPC is to encourage the industry institution interactions. Hello, Suti? Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
There's some kind of a disturbance.
I have muted him, sir.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. So interactions between industry and institutions offering technical education should lead to innovation and research. So it is just not enough only when we get tied up with regards to the placement activities and a little of elementary skills. It should be in such a way that we are going to enhance the research component, or the innovation is going to be inculcated amongst the students. So the industry academia collaborations, establishing industries centers of excellence and incubation cells in institutions, wherein already it has begun in some of the institutions which are autonomous now. For example, even at BEC, we have Bosch Rexroth, we have BEC STEP, and we have some of the incubators, almost 3 to 4 now, who are now on our campus and trying to give internship to the students. Then appointing faculty with research and industry experience. So if we take at the earlier education system, we are all here in the educational institutions without any industrial experience. Now, the government wants to lay emphasis while appointing that a faculty must have at least some background with regards to the industrial experience and the research experience. Then industry representation in board of studies, already this is happening in some of the autonomous institutions, including ours, that we have the industry personnels who have been included in our board of studies while setting up the curriculum. Then internship opportunities for the learners. This is being already started now, and government also is on the role to make it compulsory, the internship for the technical graduates. Then using state-of-the-art resources, this is inclusive both for the faculty as well as the student fraternity, which nobody can deny it now. And all of us must get equipped ourselves with the latest technologies that are available for teaching learning processes. Then the other aspect is that with regards to the UN, what it lays emphasis is with regards to the equity amongst all generations and amongst all people and amongst all community. So improving equity and inclusiveness in technical education, it lays emphasis that you have to give certain kind of scholarship and incentives to socially deprived students or underprivileged or unrepresented groups. So the focus is also being laid for the underprivileged students. So some of the reforms in higher education systems, NEP brings about a sea of changes in the higher educational institutions with an objective of creation of greater opportunities for individual employment. So the focus is going to be on this. Then to increase the gross enrollment ratio, as we already talked about it in higher education, including vocational education, from almost 26.3, which was in the year 2018, to 50% by 2035. And to overhaul the fragmented nature of India's existing higher education system and bring together higher educational institutions into large multidisciplinary universities. So this is going to be a very key thing in the national education policies. So all these HEIs, that cluster knowledge hubs, what they call it, are going to be created over a period of time, or they are going to be single system streams are going to be phased out. So the next is single stream HEIs will be phased out over a period of time. By 2030-35, you will not find the educational institutions which are not multidisciplinary. They are going to be, by and large, will be interdisciplinary or multidisciplinary. UG degree will be of either 3 or 4 year duration with multiple exit options within this period, with appropriate certification for those dropping out in between. So at the end of 1 year of technical education, whether it is in diploma course or engineering, he is going to get a certificate. Then even if the end of 2 years he can exit, he will get a certificate for the credits that he has earned. If he completes 3 years, he will get a diploma certificate. If he completes 4 years, he is going to get a degree certificate. So here the important aspect is with regards to the academic bank of credits, what they call it as ABC. So they can digitally store the credits they have earned during their period of study in any educational institutions. And subsequently, they can also go for a job and then come back and then continue their study with the credits that they have accumulated and then complete a degree. But I do not know the modalities, how these are going to be incorporated and what will be its impact. But anyway, one need to be prepared for these things. A system of granting graded autonomy based on accreditation will be adopted for colleges eventually, and aim is to transform them into an autonomous degree granting college. Now we are not a degree granting college because we are all affiliated to the universities. So subsequently, over a period of time, we have to become a degree granting colleges over a period of time. Then regulatory system, Higher Education Commission of India, HECI, will be set up as a single umbrella body for the entire higher education. So that's what I told, we have UGC, AICT and so many other regulatory bodies which are governing this. All these are going to be now eliminated and it will all come under one umbrella, excluding in this particular case the medical and legal education. Then public and private higher educational institutions will be governed by the same set of norms for regulation, accreditation and academic standards. So now the government colleges are now all left out of this accreditation part. So taking this into consideration, whether it is a private or whether it's a government, all the educational institutions are going to be bound by the same set of norms. Now under HECI, you will have four different bodies. One will be called as the National Higher Education Regulatory Council, NHERC, for regulation, General Education Council for standard settings, Higher Education Grants Council for funding, then National Accreditation Council for accreditation. So they will all function under HECI, that is Higher Education Commission of India. National Education Policy 2020, it aims at fostering innovation and creativity. And this being organized under IIC, where the more emphasis will be for this creativity and innovation. The vision of the policy is to improve the quality of education by giving an equal space to creativity and innovation and transform India into a vibrant knowledge society. So this is being quite talked about. Creativity, innovation and entrepreneurship, they remain at the heart of the policy. The Ministry of Human Resource Development, that is now the Ministry of Education, has recognized that India lags behind when it comes to research, innovation and entrepreneurship. Based on the survey that is being done, MHRD already has recognized that we are lagging in terms of research, innovation and entrepreneurship. The lack of creative and critical thinking mainly stems from the fact that the current educational framework does not award such thinking. So this has resulted in stagnation of intellectual properties, then local manufacturing and self-sustainability. These are the problems that have shot up now. Creativity leads to innovation and establishment of the National Research Foundation, which will recognize and support outstanding research. That means only for the purpose of promoting the innovation and research, there is going to be a foundation which is going to be set up and it will fund the research project. I think some of the things may not be now very relevant, I think, which I would skip. The other important is with regards to the emphasis for the digital drive, as I already talked about it. Then, given the explosive pace of technological development allied with the sheer creativity, the NEP promotes student entrepreneurs with the exposure to vocational education in partnership with industry and in alignment with the sustainable development goal as envisaged by the UN. Then integration of vocational education with the educational offerings in all institutes by choosing skill gap, analyzing and mapping of local opportunities will develop entrepreneurial competencies. So the most important thing is to map the local opportunities available in their respective areas in order to enhance the entrepreneurship and the quality of education. So the framework of 21st century learn and era of specialization. NEP 2020 will ensure the holistic development of learners, and we have to advance our students with 21st century skills. And these skills will include critical thinking, creativity, collaboration, curiosity, and communication. The foundation on which these are going to be laid will be the good learning environment, the professional development, the curriculum and instruction part to be enhanced, then standards and assessment through which the life and career skills are going to be developed, then information, media, and technology skills are going to be developed, then core subjects in the 21st century themes, then learning and innovation skills are going to be enhanced. The benefits of new education policy, some of the important things, the new education policy will give importance to students' practical thinking instead of just pushing them towards rote learning. So as already I talked about it, the most important thing will be rather than reproducing the hands-on experience that the students are going to gain in terms of having the internships and the industry institution collaborations that the institutions will establish. It will help students to develop scientific temper from a very young age. The NEP aims to make it easier to set up new quality of higher educational institutions, which will be at par with the global standards. So one of the major objectives is that to enhance the quality of these educational institutions. NEP will make it easier for foreign colleges to set up their campuses on India and Indians to set up their campuses abroad. And this will promote the value-based education, what it is now understood to be. The associated problems will always be there, but nevertheless, we need to march ahead. So coming to the end of this, the National Education Policy 2020 is an attempt to address most of the grievances of the education system which are prevailing for the past 34 years. Then quality of teaching is one of the primary agendas of the policy, and NEP has addressed to bridge the gap of gender and social equality. Then this is certainly a historic moment for all the stakeholders involved, that is the students, the teachers, as well as the parents. The restructuring of the 10 plus 2 to 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4, then the regional languages have been given due importance, then single regulatory body, then the concept of having the academic bank. We need to watch and wait how this is going to make a drastic change in the field of education. So I would rather say from the perspective of the students, it is going to be a boon, but from the perspective of the institutions, we have to wait and watch. Some of the important things that our Prime Minister has emphasized, I have taken the glimpses of that. NEP aims to transform the intent and content of education sector. NEP focuses on shifting the burden of school bag to the boon of learning. So the curriculum is going to be made more lighter than what it means. National education policy focuses on integrating local with the global. So Indians abroad, abroad in India. Then NEP aims at making the youth future ready while focusing on the national goals. So not only making them ready for the present day problems, also emphasizing on them to be future ready with the challenges that or the problems that we are going to face in the days to come. NEP ensures that students become global citizens while remaining connected to their roots. So this is a very nice message that is being given by our Prime Minister. Then NEP aims to shift focus from what to think to how to think. Then higher education institutions need to be empowered through autonomy. This is very much important. There is a great emphasis on teacher training in national education policy. To conclude, rather I would say, the policy is based on the pillars of access, equity, quality, affordability, accountability to transform India into a vibrant knowledge hub. This is again by our Prime Minister. Then the chairman of NEP committee, Sri Kasturi Rangan, says transforming and creating a dynamic education system is fundamental for the progress of any country, and India is no different. The idea is to open our minds to excellence. So with this, rather, I would conclude, and I think I have done justice with regards to what has been assigned to me. So if there are any questions, if there are any suggestions and comments, you are most welcome, please.
If anyone wants to ask the questions to sir, you can ask. Shilatam madam, you have raised the hand.
Sorry. Madam? Sorry,
hello.
Sir.
Hello, ma'am.
Sorry. Sorry, by mistake.
Okay, ma'am. Any questions from the students' side? Okay. Thank you so much, sir. We really appreciate you taking out time for us from your busy schedule. It's always been our pleasure to have you with us, sir.
Thank you, Sandeep. I thank all the audience for being present and listening patiently. The unfortunate thing is that there are no questions. The questions from the audience always make the speakers a little more extra alert in preparing the things. But nevertheless, I thank all the participants for this particular webinar and the organizers for having organized this webinar.
Okay, sir. Thank you. And at last, I request Shruti Madam to propose vote of thanks.
Thank you, sir. We all know that India is supporting youth towards entrepreneurship and be the part of Atmanirbhar Bharat program. National education policy plays a vital role. My gratitude to our super energetic speaker for this evening, our principal, Dr. S.S. Injangiri, sir. Thank you for giving your valuable time from your busy schedule. It's indeed an enlightening session on Educational Policy 2020 with a focus on innovation and entrepreneurship. Thank you, sir. I thank Dr. Anil Devangami, sir, for his unfaltering support in organizing the event. My gratitude to all the department heads, faculties, IIC team members, and my dear participants for joining the live session with. Thank you once again. We'll end this session here. Have a great evening ahead.
Thank you, madam. And thanks to everyone who have joined. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.